Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of Bad for Your Health Entertainment. I'm Tom, joined by my main man,
Dunzilla.
And tonight we're joined once again by good friend of the page, good friend of mine, the amazing Spider-Man himself, Dan Poole, best known for his work on The Green Goblin's Last Stand. Dan, how's it going tonight?
It's going great. Thanks for having me back. It's a ton of fun. Nice to meet you, Dan, finally.
Pleasure to have you.
Anytime. Dunzilla, how are you, bud?
Not bad. Pretty good. You?
I'm doing good, man. It's good time, good weekend.
Yeah.
Let's kick it into gear. Let's just go with it, guys. Tonight we're talking about the legendary Amazing Spider-Man. Well, actually, it wasn't Amazing Spider-Man. It was in all three titles. The legendary Spider-Man story, Kraven's Last Hunt, written by J.M. DeMatteis, illustrated by Mike Zeck and Bob McLeod. And it's an iconic storyline. There you go. There it is. Part five.
Yeah.
Part Did five. You? It's spread throughout Web of Spider-Man's 31 and 32, Amazing 293 and 294, and Peter Parker the Spectacular 131 and 132. Dan, you were there back in the day when it came out.
I was there. I watched him draw this. Yes.
You were there. I mean, like, you were there. Were you getting ready to make the Spider-Man movies around the time that this story came out? It was 87-ish, right?
Yeah, no, this was before. I got the bug. Did you see what I did there?
Nice.
Right around 88. So this was right around that time. Maybe this was one that pushed me over. No, it was right around the time, but not yet. No, 88 was when I read Stan's thing and got crazy.
Yeah.
So not yet.
But you remember, you when we spoke about Green Goblin's Last Stand, you told me how crazy you were about Marvel. You were a Marvel fan, and you had so many titles.
Oh, yeah. I had it started with Amazing Spider-Man. And then what's funny is I don't know what everybody's origin story is about how they learned of comic books and comic book titles and stuff. But I just like Spider-Man, like drawing him. I got the book How to Draw Comics the Marvel Way when I was like 12. And I still do. Oh, my God, I love that book. I still own it. I still use it sometimes. But the point being, I didn't actually start collecting comic books until a couple of years later. There was a local comic book shop, and I grabbed Amazing. And then I noticed there was a Peter Parker Spectacular. And I didn't understand. I remember my confusion. It was like comic book collecting 101. Like, no, there's another title. And then slowly it was explained to me that, oh, yeah, well, he's so popular, they have to kick out, you know, other titles for other teams to write and draw so they make more money because the demand is there. So then there's Spectacular that began in the 70s, and then there's Web Of. And I was telling you, Tom, earlier that I was really excited for Web Of.
That iconic cover with him in the black suit, number one.
Is that Web? Yes. That yes, exactly.
Yep.
Right. But what was exciting was that I was alive and collecting when it debuted. And so there I was, when you think of, you know, fathers, grandfathers, uncles, whatever, that were collecting in the 60s and 70s for Peter Parker, Spectacular. And then a new title rolled out. I was like, oh, I get the first. That was really cool. And I had hoped it would sustain itself like it had. So that was pretty exciting for me. And then it I was getting off four titles of Spidey.
Right?
Oh, man, I team up, What If, all of them. And then I got Avengers, X-Men, and then I go down the list of Marvel stuff. I didn't get any DC stuff. I didn't have the money or the time. I'm like, make mine Marvel, baby.
Make mine Marvel. So what was the – do you remember what the first Spider-Man book you ever bought was? It was amazing. Do you remember the issue? Everyone usually remembers their first.
Yeah, you never forget your first.
I do.
I do too.
Tell me while I'm thinking about it. What was yours?
Dunzilla.
Spider-Man 34, the Vengeance storyline. I actually had Bob McLeod sign part one and two. So
that's cool.
Yep.
That is pretty cool.
I got it at a gas
I was
station.
There.
I bought it back at a gas station in New Hampshire when I was a kid.
Oh.
I was like maybe 7 years old.
Wow. And you knew enough to want to hang on to it at seven?
I actually still have it. It's all beat up, but I have a fresh, I have a nice mint copy, but I still have that first one. It's all beat up, beat to shit, but I still got it.
I'm sure it's wrinkled, at the top where you were holding it with one hand on a lot of legs.
Oh, yeah.
See, that's never
mind. Mine was Amazing 415. That was when that was during the Onslaught crossover and Spider-Man was fighting it was actually Ben Reilly at the time. And Ben Reilly was like on the building looking down and the Sentinel was like looking up. And I just was like, I knew the Sentinels from the X-Men cartoon. And I was like, whoa, you know, fighting Spider-Man. Then I'm like reading about Ben Reilly. And I was like, that was Ben Reilly. And then Onslaught. And then I was like, I loved Onslaught, but the whole clone thing, Dan, you and I, done. We've talked about that a zillion times. I just roll my eyes at the whole.
It's been so Marvel with their overdone.
Marvel with their clonage.
And now it made its way into Star Wars. The whole the clonage thing. Oh, Snoke was a clone of Palpatine. You know, whatever. That's a different conversation.
Yeah,
right. I can't think of my first one because I don't know that there was I don't know that there was an issue that was such an iconic cover or story that grabbed me. I just knew I wanted. I just started compiling them. I just started grabbing. I can tell you the only book that ever grabbed me from the cover that I remember, because I'm sure there are plenty. The reason I got into the Avengers was because of a cover. I'd have to go rummage through the boxes to find out what number, but it was a cover of the Avengers. It was the team. It was mid or late 80s. And it was Thor with the beard and he was on the front. And
Eric Masterson Thor.
I think so. I can't swear to it. But the Thor was the Walt Simonson Thor, where he had just gotten punched through the Rainbow Bridge by Surtur, and it was the next issue where he was like steaming and coming back, and he had damage all over. I always dug that.
That's cool.
When they had damage to the superheroes, just again showing the Marvel, these guys are vulnerable in some way, or at least the fabric they build their costumes out of are. So I remember that issue. I don't remember the number, but I had Simonson sign that one at a convention. That was pretty cool.
Oh, that's cool.
Spidey wise, I don't have an answer for you guys, but it makes me wonder. I actually might go sift through the books later and see if one jars a memory. But
damn,
yeah.
Every story's got a good story. But you were there at the beginning of Web of, and were you reading Web of the whole time?
Absolutely. My life was working all week at the National Aquarium in Baltimore at the time. I would take the bus home, get off the bus, and go to Comic Book Kingdom in Lauraville, Baltimore City. Grab my titles, whatever was in for me for the week, because that's how I was doing it then, man. I was ordering. I signed up for titles. And when they came in, he just took a nice brand new copy and put it in the pile for me and whoever was signed up to subscribe. Then I walked home, four blocks, put them next to the morning desk. And then after running around doing whatever all weekend, Sunday night, man, turn on some classical music and just read my stories,
Yeah.
Howard Jones.
No Howard Jones. Put him in the classical category. But I was reading all kinds of titles, man. Absolutely devoured them when I got them.
Now, this was back when comics came out on Friday, right? It was the Friday days. So when around the time Kraven's Last Hunt came out, were there any rumblings? Like, was anyone saying to you, hey, there's this, this really big storyline's coming out with Kraven?
I got to say, no, it wasn't like that. The guy that ran the shop, he might as well have been running an antique store or a flea market for all he cared. He just knew comics made money. So he just had them lined up. And I can't say there wasn't a culture or a vibe like there has been since, at least in my neighborhood. I just knew where to get them. I knew where to get my fix. I knew where my man was. I got them. I don't even remember talking comic books to friends back then. No, none of my friends were into them.
No.
And I really got into them for the art and everything they bring us, the stories. And I mean, nobody saw them like we see them. I mean, people might tune into this and be like, I don't get it. Like, yeah, I know you don't, and you don't have to watch. But no, there was no vibe. There was no rumblings. There was no, I didn't have my finger on the pulse of comics. But when those, when those issues came on Friday, I was just like, yeah, cool. So
So you got all of them when they going to Kravens Last Stand. I was doing a little bit of research myself, and I guess apparently Demattis had pitched it as a Wonder Man series with his brother, the Grim Reaper, burying him, and then Wonder Man having to come back, and then that was not approved. I believe Tom DeFalco was the editor in chief at the time.
That would have been
DeFalco.
That would have been awesome.
Because DeFalco was the EIC here, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
So he just kept it in his pocket. He was just like, oh, sounds great, that but was. You know what?
But Demattis pitched it to him, and then I guess he pitched it to DC at one point, and then I get as a Batman Joker or Hugo Strange story, which they ended up doing, I guess, in Legends of Dark Knight. I was reading about it a little bit before. But then Demattis had pitched it with an original villain, and I guess when he was writing the original Marvel handbook, like of all the characters, that big thing that came out way back in the day, he saw Kraven and he was like, "Kraven, this could work."
Wait, Tom, I got to ask you about that. The Marvel Encyclopedia.
I think that's what it was back in the '80s.
Yeah, but it was. So, are you saying it was just one graphic novel, one thing?
I don't know what it was. I've heard of it, but I've never seen it.
Oh, because what was cool? Because I'm sure it is now one bound, you know, book. But I have all the issues when the Marvel Encyclopedia came out in issues, man. And
the index.
Yeah. Marvel Universe. Yeah, it was pretty neat, man. Sitting there like, oh, that's how tall Spidey is? Oh, really? Right, like 5'8" or some shit, 5'9". You know,
I might have misspoke on that, but that's how he got in the whole Kraven. He was like, hey, okay, we could use something with Kraven here.
Right, right. Let me go to my notes here. I made notes for this. I got so if we get into each issue, I got notes, man.
You got the notes.
I got notes.
Kraven's first appearance was amazing. 15.
Was it really?
It was amazing because I almost made the mistake at a convention. Dunzilla, you remember this? Mm-hmm. I think it was had to be one of the Terrificons, and it was like an amazing 40, 37 or something like that. I don't know the exact number, but it was the one where Spider-Man's on the roof, on the side of the building, and Kraven's going to jump on him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, yo, I think that's first Kraven. And I was like, I was thinking about buying it. I had my money out. It was like $60 book because it was like a near mint. And I was like, I don't know, Dunzilla, what do you think? And he's like, I don't think that's his first appearance. And I'm like, yeah, I think you're right. So
I think
thank God I didn't buy it.
I think that was his second appearance or third.
Yeah, it was like second or third.
Yeah.
But what I didn't know I forgot about was he was Chameleon's stepbrother.
Kraven?
Really?
Yeah, dude.
Really? I didn't know that. Wow. That's interesting.
We could do a whole show on that.
That's an underused character, Chameleon.
Oh, dude, Chameleon is so underrated.
Stepbrother? Well, who married who? So his mother killed her. Craven's, now you got me thinking about the Kravenoff bloodline. Like, who got remarried?
Well, Kraven was what, like 70 years old at the time of last
one? Right. He was a Highlander.
He was a Highlander. the Russian Highlander.
You know what struck me as I reread these earlier was how he's like, I'm going to die soon. I must die soon. Like he was tired.
Must die soon.
Like, man, I'm done, dude. I'm like, I'm out. I just got.
And that was the one thing I actually dug about it rereading. A lot happens. Like it's all in the head.
Yes. Yeah.
It's all like, well, and you know, one of the issues is like straight up Kraven's point of view.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I found the first thing that struck me was how dark. Well, the first thing that struck me was when you open up, where does it start? Web of
31. Yeah, web of the first panel.
Yeah, first. Well, it's a page. The panel's as big. Yeah, he's in the Spidey pose. Love that. I have.
And he rips that gorilla's head off.
Just like. Straight palms it off, and I'm like, is that supposed to be a stuffed gorilla? I'm like, he's really strong, you know. It's an interesting and also the way, yeah, there you go. In case anyone's wondering,
holy crap.
Yeah,
that's bad. Johnny caged him, holy shit,
right? And he ain't no monkey no more. All the way they used the words too in different panels, like come out, come out, come out. I don't remember seeing I don't remember the usage like that. Well, of course, this is a pretty specific story or saga, but the way the graphics were used, the text was pretty neat, you know, to illustrate.
Like the lettering?
Yeah, man, just that detached. I think everything about this run, just the way it was done in that style of thoughts, and it was thought driven, and it. Yes. Even, I mean, everybody, like even Mary Jane.
And when she's trying to kill the rat later in the, I think it was issue one.
All of it. Every time a new character is introduced, they've got like we start on their thoughts, and they're almost always dark. And I'll bring this up in case we run out of time and I forget. But did you guys notice how every single book is night and rainy?
Yep.
It's raining
night and rain.
Until he lures Vermin up, and then it's bright out, and then the sun sets on Kraven's grave. I had to go back and make sure I was looking at that. I was like, oh, gosh, dark and rainy again. Oh, it's dark and rainy again. It's just one of those elements that you just – for me personally, I don't really perceive, but somewhere it's setting in, and it helps with the story and the mood. And I'm like, oh, just another thing that people might blow off when they think of comic books, but you think there was some thought behind this, you know?
There was thought and character, and as you said, it was a contrast between the light of the story, the darkness of the actual story, and almost the darkness of the characters is yet still illuminated with that light. And it was just kind of like, as you said, Dan, not everyone would pick up on that, and we've all been bit by the Marvel bug, and we get it.
Yeah, it's I just always said that I've always said every single issue of every decent comic book is a movie waiting to be done, and here's your script and storyboard. Your storyboard,
exactly.
And this,
it's right here.
This is one of the best examples, because I think of when they do comic book composition, the panels really dictate the pacing. And
yes.
And I noticed in this run more than maybe ever, as far as putting thought into it. Because a lot of times, I'll be honest with you, I don't necessarily pick the books apart a lot for art, but I appreciate it as I go. But going back and wanting to pay attention, so when we, you know, for tonight's show, I really paid attention and really appreciated how the panels dictated the pacing, with like long ones that are horizontal that just have a little bit going on each time, and it really made you slow down and appreciate it. Almost, it was so cinematic.
Exactly. It was just because it was cinematic. You could almost see like an actor sort of walking and the camera cutting, even just simple scenes. It's Kraven going into the tombstone, you know, saying, "I must die."
Yeah. It really impressed me. It was good. It's good storytelling. And it's definitely its own art form, how it leads you the way it wants you to consume it. You know, we're going to slow here, big here.
That inspired you to do what you did with Goblin's Last Stand, because some of your shots in that movie are straight comic shots.
Yeah. Yeah.
Straight.
One of the coolest things I've seen, sorry, I'm just gotta throw this out there. But I don't see a ton of them in the MCU. I see a few, but the ones that stick out and grab me and excite me, the best one, I was a big Simonson fan, I was a big Thor fan. Man, in was it Ragnarok, when he comes back to fight his sister,
Hela.
Yeah, and he channels the lightning, and there's that big wide shot, and he's silhouetted, and the lightning bolt, like, oh, and he's
almost cool.
Crowd. Oh my god, man, that, oh, I rewound that a couple times, but I remember seeing it in the theater, just going, oh, like that's what you read the books for, man. That. Just that images, man. You weren't getting that imagery.
And that shot of his one good eye lighting up with lightning and shit.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. The poster shots. That's what it was all about.
Yep.
Yeah, man. Well,
the superheroes in that dramatic pose that just sort of.
Yeah. Yeah. That was stuff, man.
That was the movie, pretty much.
Really, really was. So, you know, the same thing with these and how the panels. Led you to the iconic pages. You know, a lot of them in this series were the very opening, the very ending of each book, which was it's really cool. Also, you got to wonder about the marketing side of this. They're like, well, let's just not leave it in Amazing. We could probably push some Peter Parkers and Web of if we did like a little crossover here.
It's funny you say that, because I guess originally it was supposed to be in Peter Parker Spectacular.
There you go.
They were just going to do a 6-issue, and then they were like, this is too cool to be in just one title, and they spread it out all three with the same creative team.
That I did not know until I was looking this morning making notes. And a name you failed to mention that impressed me was The Colorist. Did you notice who The Colorist was? I'm a big fan.
Bob Sharon?
No, I'm a big fan of her work, and I'm surprised she found time to do this back then, because she was kind of at the height of her career, arguably. Miss Janet Jackson.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah. Bob Sharon was in it too with Zach.
Yeah, I know. It's I was surprised that the same creative team did it throughout the arc. Because I thought I was, you know, going back, I honestly never really remembered.
You never,
I never
really followed specific writers or artists, did you?
Not until I gotta say, oh my God, Dave, no. David, shit. Oh. Peter David, oh. Writer, and then, but the so I did. I started to take note of what he was doing, and I became a huge Walter and Louise Simonson fan.
Awesome.
And Romita was just so stylistic, and Romita Jr., and then of course my man McFarlane when he came along. So the ones that really made me pay attention, I'll say that I just consumed them for what I enjoyed about them. And then when a certain artist or certain writer really got my attention, I was like, who did that? And then I did follow them a bit. Yeah.
That's pretty cool. Dunzilla, you've had a few that you followed over the years. I mean, I admit it. I follow McFarlane.
Oh yeah. I was a huge Walter Simonson Thor guy.
So fun.
Peter David. Mm-hmm. I followed when I was a kid. And then obviously Todd with his Spider-Man run.
Yeah.
Who were Mark Grunwald's Captain America run grabbed me when I was getting into comics. It was Mark Grunwald.
Oh, mm-hmm. And Ron Lim Silver Surfer. Ron Lim. Oh. Great artist.
Yeah, good call.
Yeah. That was I had
his was it Lim? Might not have been Lim. It might have been never mind. Never mind. Maybe it might have been Jusco. Jusco might have did a Joe Jusco. There was another guy, and of course,
Joe Jusco.
Yeah,
Double J.
I had a Silver Surfer. God, I need to go back and find out who that was. But I cut out the poster and laminated it to a just glued it to some poster board. Mm-hmm. So it was a little, you know, it had some substance, and then glued it to my basement bedroom wall, and then painted the whole wall like the galaxy and had him in the middle.
Awesome. It was cool. That's pretty cool.
That's cool. Yeah.
It was my man boy cave.
Man boy cave.
Yeah.
What was the poster of again? I'm sorry. What was the poster of?
Surfer.
Yeah.
You remember the pose? Like, what was he like?
Yeah. Coming at you. Coming
classic
at you.
Classic surfer.
Mm-hmm. Power Cosmic lit up in one hand, man. He, yeah, it was all over the Marvel universe, man. I love so many books, characters, titles, man. I even got into Punisher, the Nom. I got into Power Pack. If you remember that fact,
I remember Power Pack. Nomad.
Yeah, I have all that. Anyway, all right. So I'm sorry. I want to keep focused on a message.
But you know what was funny? You said the very first panel. You know, I don't want to jump ahead, but what struck me when I was rereading it was how the first issue starts in the first panel in the second issue. Boom.
Oh, good call.
Nice yep. little contrast there.
Yes.
Nice. Oh, it's doing the same pose.
No, man. We'll stay on that.
Go, Dan. Yeah, I know, dude, I see your light bulbs going off. Go.
Go for it. The floor is
yours, man.
So it's been a long time since I read these. So, because Tom, you asked me a while ago what were some of my favorite storylines. And obviously, the Green Goblin's Last Stand, the day Gwen Stacy died. And then this, like a lot of people, just stands out. But I hadn't read it since I first read it. So, going back but before I dug them out of my collection, I started to think about the black costume. Or, no, I'm sorry. It's when I had them out, I had them sitting around my place for a week. And I noticed the black costume and I thought, this had to be after Venom. But in my mind, I was thinking, but it seems too early for Venom. Definitely Secret Wars because he's got the black costume. But I'm thinking, can you imagine if Kraven didn't know that that was a symbiote?
Yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah.
Wow.
Went to mess with him, and then you know, the suit just whipped his ass real quick. Every chat Spider-Man, I'd have been – I just thought about that as a what if for a while. And so what I asked you when we were getting ready earlier is that's what I didn't research, that I really wanted to research before we did this show is
– like where it fit in the timeline?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, it was a few months before – it was what? Amazing 294 was the last one. Venom didn't show up till what, 298 when you see his arm or whatever?
297. Right,
that was eight.
Wasn't that his arm or his hand?
Historians, I love it.
Because 99 is when he's doing the whole honey on home. Ah!
So
yeah, it was 298. Yeah, yeah.
So that was Todd's first issue.
Yeah, where you just see the hand. Yeah,
and then like before this, like the issues before that were like part of the Hobgoblin shit, and then some robot in Pittsburgh, or it was just weird stuff.
great title for a number of things.
The robot in Pittsburgh.
Yeah, his name's Ben Worthless Booger.
Yeah, it's like some purple thing, and you know, he's like, and Peter's like,
oh,
the Spider Slayer.
No, it wasn't a Spider Slayer because those. I don't think those showed up till a little later.
Oh yeah, that was in the 300s. That's right. Yeah.
All right, so. But then it got me, and not to get off on a tangent, but maybe you can help me just clean it up real quick in my head. So timeline-wise, he finds out this thing's – and I was explaining this to somebody that asked me about the black costume. I was like, oh, yeah, the Secret Wars, man, the Beyonder and, you know
– oh, Beyonder was so awesome.
It was deep, man. I'll never forget whoever wrote that issue, but when he came to visit Peter Parker and he was in this, like, all-white
like Star Trek thing?
Yeah, and he goes. He decided to take a human form to come see what all the fuss was about being a human, right? And he said, "Parker, I have this pressure in my lower abdomen." He's like, "You gotta go to the bathroom." He's like, "What's that?" But I never forgot that wording. I have this strange pressure in my lower abdomen. So I've used that line for a millennia now. Anyway,
seems like a lifetime ago, doesn't it? Since those books came out.
Yes, it does. But so he got tired of he separated himself from the alien, and then yep. Eddie Brock got it, and they scurried off.
See, it's weird because I thought he separated from the symbiote in like Web of Number One, like the whole scene, right. Like the one in the church.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I thought 300 went back and kind of revisited that.
Okay, but it was
300's over there. I'm not going to get it.
Right. But then it made me wonder. It made me have to think back. I'm like, well, wait a minute. Why did he just not go back to his red and blues right away? Like, did he go? Oh, but everybody knows me in the black suit now, and it's nice to have formal wear. Like, did he just like want to keep it for? You know, why would he want?
He kept it really until like what 301?
Yeah. 301 was where he wore the red and blue again.
Hmm. Okay. So this is leading right up to it.
Yeah, it was like this was a couple of months before Venom, the whole 298, 299, 300, and then McFarlane's legendary run on the title.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I'll ask you guys this. I'm gonna jump since we're talking about the costume.
I'm gonna
jump to one of my last notes about this saga is that Kraven going through I am the spider, I am the spider. One of the things I kind of dug in rereading this was it was funny how he went on this kind of journey of discovery and how Kraven, even though he had a plan and he knew this was his, you know, last stand, how he actually came to have respect for Spider-Man as his role as just in his life as far as an adversary in however he framed that. And even
I always interpreted it as Kraven, as you said, grew to respect Spider-Man, and he kind of understood, I am the spider, I'm the spider. But now and then I always kind of got it as always a man.
Yeah.
But the big difference between Kraven and Peter Parker was obviously Peter Parker's compassion and humanity and love. Kraven has love, but Kraven has a very unique sense of code and honor.
And he discovered, he says that, right? He says, oh, he's a man, a good man.
A good man.
Yeah, but now you got me thinking, oh, no wonder Kraven was always after Spider-Man. He just likes smashing critters. He's like, oh, Spider-Man.
Yeah, you know, in issue two, actually, it was issue one or two, where he's like eating the spiders, where he's like, and Peter's having the nightmare.
Yeah.
Nuts.
So my note was, after all he went through and all the respect that he wanted from his or for his family, but they buried him, as per his wishes, obviously, in the Spider-Man costume.
Weird.
Yeah. Yeah, just, and his head was still,
because it was like the one thing he could never, he finally did the one thing he couldn't do. He beat Spider-Man.
Pretty quickly, by the way. Like, even when I was like rereading, I thought he did that like a couple panels, didn't he?
And a couple panels, and he took him down with the net and the drug, and then, you know, come on, Kraven, guns aren't your thing. Stop being such a wimp or whatever. And all of a sudden, Kraven just got the gun, and he's just like,
blam.
And then everything just goes black.
Spidey's like, oh, I've seen this before. Oh, what time we've done this episode? He's going to drag me to a warehouse, and, you know, he's going to pontificate around for a few minutes, and then I'll figure something out.
Yeah.
He's like, oh, I'm in a grave. Neat.
But the grave was so cool, because it's like, I mean, Zach's artwork is just great. I don't want to show all the artwork, because people might want to actually read the trade or whatnot, but like, shows him obviously bigger than Peter, remorse, and then just...
Yeah, he's a crazy person. I dug that about. I dug, you know, isn't that what makes the coolest villains, like the Green Goblin, Doc Ock? They get so much joy out of, you know, causing trouble.
Yeah.
But Kraven just got so much fun hunting.
He was really good at it. You know, he just dropped off in a helicopter, and he's like, yeah, he's over there in Manhattan, right? But then Spider-Man kind of does the same thing. So now I'm going to just have some fun. We all know this is a really cool series, man. Spanned, you know, three titles, and it was very interesting. It was unlike anything else that was going on that I was reading. But then I have to ask, all right, where was this mansion / compound / graveyard? He does say he's in a grave, you know, he's hundreds of miles away. So I'm like, okay, maybe upstate New York, right?
Yeah.
But then they're in Manhattan, in like, you know, another page. Even Spidey, who can't fly.
Yep. Rereading that, I thought the same thing. I'm like, they're not in, you know, Central Park. They're not in where I'm like, I kind of attribute that to the, how did Christian Bale re-enter Gotham City in Dark Knight Rises?
Oh, God.
Totally skipped it. It just showed up.
Let's just skip a major, like, just something that would take.
Oh, what's up? I'm here to say. Well,
no, I saw a YouTube. I saw a YouTube video about that, and they answer every single one of those plot problems with the same answer, because he's Batman. That's it. So they came in there, and then they, okay, so let's take out the distance time travel. But then Spidey just magically knows where Kraven is after he...
Wounded, mind you. He's wounded with no larynx and everything. And
maybe the guards, the two guys that he beat up, you know, or threatened, maybe they just said, yeah, he's in his townhome in, you know, in Queens. Or not Queens, but like the village. He's in the village. He's in the village, man. But then after Kraven pits Spidey against Vermin, and then... you know, let Spidey go catch him.
Yeah.
Spidey just knows right where to go find Vermin in the city.
Well, they had met, I think, once before.
Oh, but that never... you guys got to tell me when Captain America, they kept referencing Captain America and Spider-Man beating up Vermin.
That Marvel was... team up 128.
Bam! All right, I'm going to check that out. 128, okay.
And Vermin first appeared in Cap 272, which that was during Zek's run on Cap.
Hmm. So Zach, that's Zach's boy.
Got a thing.
Zach was cool. Zach was cool when I met him.
Oh yeah.
Not my favorite. Not my least favorite.
He was all right.
He was all right.
He probably had a rat calf tattoo.
He was just, when I met Mike Zach, he was just kind of sitting there. He had his pen, his glasses. He had like a nice shirt, and people were just handing him Kraven's Last Hunt and like some other things. I brought him one, and I brought him the Cap thing, and He goes, "Oh, I don't get a lot of caps. You want the print?" And I said, "Yeah, sure." He's like, $10. I'll even sign it for you." I was like, "Hey, cool.
Nice.
Thanks, Zach." I don't think I called him Mike.
Zach. Big Z.
no, but you know, what were your thoughts back in the day reading it where Kraven in the end of part five just commit suicide?
Yeah, man. Different, you know. I had by then really come to appreciate Marvel for doing all the stuff that they, you know, were known for doing. And it was definitely, yeah, spoiler alert.
the guy with Full Metal Jacket on himself.
Right. Private Pile. The friggin' hunt will be over by the time you get your ass up there.
Hey, Joker.
You think you're Spider-Man? Oh my God. We're gonna do a whole show on Full Metal Jacket, Kraven's Last Hunt. Oh.
I'm in.
We could somehow compare it to The Abyss. It's
a great movie.
Oh, there's nothing like the first half of that movie.
No way.
I will say this, Tom, it was shocking. It was shocking because, you know, they didn't do a whole lot of blood. The whole thing was about death, but comic books were always about, you know, you fight this guy, you get the best of him, he gets the best of you. You see each other again, you put him away, you fight the problem, but you'll see
the never ending serial.
Yeah, which is fine when they reinvent it and you find another way to do it. That's cool. But then he eats a bullet because he's done. He's proved he's got nothing left to prove. He's got no one left. He's just kind of done. And I was like, I remember thinking, well, he ain't coming back. You know, it's not some gimmick where you might, you know, Cap goes in the ocean or, you know, the surfer, whatever.
Yeah.
They're gone for a little while.
The typical Marvel thing where they go away and come back. Phoenix. Phoenix is a prime example.
And that's fun because, you know, you kind of have that anticipation. Oh, I wonder how they're going to bring them back, you know?
Yeah.
But this was like, oh, that's the end of Kraven. Like some relative might have taken his place over time. But I mean, Kraven, the hunter.
His daughter, I think.
Gone.
I think his daughter gone. Took his place.
There you go. So you knew that would happen. But as far as this man that we knew as an adversary for Spider-Man, I thought, wow, that was pretty definitive right there.
Not many Spider-Man villains were killed off at that time. I mean, what, Goblin?
Right? I can't think of any others that were.
I can't think of Doc Ock was always floating around.
Goblin and Kraven.
Yeah,
it was pretty much.
Yeah, that was pretty. It was kind of heavy for a comic book.
Yeah,
it was kind of heavy. I was like, oh,
you know, the other thing about it was Kraven had proven what he wanted to do, which was beat Spider-Man and almost be his superior. When I was reading that, I was like, Marvel ended up doing that with Doc Ock. Done. What was it like? 20? That was almost 10 years ago when they did Superior Spider-Man, right?
2012.
Almost 10 years ago. Yeah, when Doc Ock became Peter and it was just, I'll be better than he ever was. I will Spider-Man be the superior Spider-Man.
Spider-Man 700.
Yeah.
Wow. The big anniversary issue, yeah.
Wow.
It made me think of that for a second because that's all Kraven wanted to do. Was just
Doc Ock became Spider-Man and Peter was dead.
That's all after my time.
It was a little after mine because I haven't really picked up a Spider-Man issue in God.
Yeah.
2009.
Long time. Yeah.
it's certainly endlessly entertaining. Yeah, I'm just looking at all the covers spread out here on my table.
All so. Cool covers. All just so well done by Zach.
Yeah.
Just fun beautiful. Stuff. And the colors by Janet Jackson. It's just main colorist. Main colorist, Janet Jackson.
She was so talented. He was so
multi-talented.
Draw, color, everything.
Yeah. Actually, just listening to some of her music the other day.
What happened?
I said I was just listening to some of her music the other day.
Oh, nothing wrong with that. I was listening to Howard Jones the other day.
Oh my God! You love to hit me
That's
with that.
True reference. Story, man. You and I were texting one time back and forth, Dan, and I was driving. I was not texting
You're
and driving.
Texting and driving.
Nope, driving. I had the audio going through, so it would say, Dan Poole says this, and then all of a sudden my next song came on. It was Howard Jones' Equality. I was like, oh, dear God.
Dan's controlling my radio? This is ridiculous.
I'm like, what the hell is this?
Never forget. Never forget.
Never forget Howard Jones.
That's right.
So, Dan, when back in the day when you were getting ready to make Goblin, we talked about this briefly. You had considered doing a Kraven short. Am I right on that?
No, not a short. I had considered very seriously making him. In fact, Tom, he was going to be part of that 4-minute action trailer that I was telling you about, where it was going to be. So once I found out, because I had hung up the tights, right? I was done. I was like, I had done this 50-minute, The Quick and the Dead with Bullseye and Kingpin. Again, what I considered terrestrial characters.
Yep.
Nothing crazy. They can't fly. They can't do. I mean, they were just the Kingpin, Bullseye. All right, I can work with that. And then I just didn't know what else I could do with zero money. I had a ton of friends and great support, but none of us were, you know, none of us knew how to do that crazy shit. So I find out Cameron's involved, and I'm like, oh my god, oh my god, oh my god, I gotta. How can I impress this guy? We're doing Venom, right? That's my first thought was Venom, and to be honest. I'll bet you I know, right? But I just wanted to see my first thought was, who do I want to see Spider-Man fight? And my first thought was Venom.
Venom.
And then I went to they all might have flooded at one time. But I do remember thinking of the people I could pull off, Kraven would be right there. But I didn't – I can't totally remember and give you an honest answer about why I didn't do him before this, but he was part of my, the slated villains that I was going to put in this 4-minute action trailer. I was going to have just a quick scene, just anything, any quick action scene of the Green Goblin, Kraven, Doc Ock, maybe the Vulture. who am I missing? Shit. Venom. And so I had Eric start working on the Venom mask.
That's my Vulture impression. The old Vulture.
So he was. I was going to do it. But then the Green Goblin just took on a life of its own. That whole project just it just ballooned out of I don't know, I got obsessed with it, man. I just shelved the other guys. I was like, you know what? I can get 4 minutes out of the Mysterio footage we have and you know, the previous stuff. And you saw a little bit of the Bullseye stuff in that trailer. Yeah, I wanted to do Kraven. I did. I thought it'd be a lot of fun.
How would you have done it?
Yeah, I think I was telling you, I would have solicited a bodybuilder from a local gym or something. Been like, it's not what you think. It's not what you think. Yeah, right, right. You know, some adult actor. You know, my cousin was into bodybuilding. He might have done it. Although he played Wolverine, so he was a little short to play Kraven. But yeah. I would have had to have found a bodybuilder and talked him into just putting on this ridiculous outfit and jumping around a little bit. That's it. I mean, it's
simple as that.
Yeah, and it just would have been. You know what it would have been, Tom? It probably would have been. Hey, do me a favor. Get all pumped up. Wear this, loincloth and this lion's mane, and I'm gonna get a mini trampoline. I'm just gonna do some flips over you, stuff like that. I'm gonna, if I elbow you, you know, act like it really hurt. Then you can throw. I'm gonna let you throw a spear at me too. That'll be fun. Yeah, I don't know. I would have made him. I would have said, "Are you afraid of heights? I'm gonna need you on a rooftop."
That'd be great. All you need is an outtake of Kraven the Hunter, like.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. Probably would have had him snacking on a pigeon, like watching Spidey swing by and then go chase him. I don't know. I don't know, man. But
the funny thing about Kraven is out of all the Spider-Man villains, all the movies that Sony did that are and we've talked about a couple of times, done, you and I have talked about it for almost 20 years now. Mm-hmm. Kraven's the one they never tried out of all the legends. And I don't even know if you want to put Hobgoblin in the legendary category.
I might. He was a big part of the 80s, man, for me.
Big.
But it's probably because he's arguably just not having superpowers, man. And I'll bet it'd be tough to drag that out. Unless it was this storyline. I don't know what Kraven could really offer.
The funny thing is that I've read that he has been considered for projects, or at least small cameos, or, you know, the Sergei Kravenov character appearing. But I was reading that, and I don't know who has. I think Sony has the rights to Kraven, part of the deal that they had with the Spider-Man thing. Yep. I've heard everything from Marvel wanted to put him in the Black Panther movie at one point as a potential foe over Killmonger. I read that, which actually would have made sense.
Yep.
And then there's a rumor now that Keanu Reeves is going to play him in the Sony Marvel cinematic. What was the hell called? It was like the cinematic universe of Marvel characters that Sony has.
Last I read about that, Venom. Keanu actually turned that down.
Keanu turned it down?
Yep. But they still want to do something with Kraven. They just don't know who they're going to cast.
The only direction you could really go, and Dan just hit it, you know, he doesn't have any superpowers. Yep. But you'd have to almost tell this specific story.
Or take the element of this story. I got to tell you guys, have you guys ever – I just don't know how alone I am in some of the dumb shit I've thought over the years about superheroes. But have you guys ever, like, really given thought to how Spider-Man could be taken out? Like, why supervillains haven't done certain things, like lure him into a room where the walls are just oiled?
All the time. How you could totally mess with somebody.
Yeah. So the way he gets him, you know, it was – I really wanted to see – well, he did. He didn't take two shots at him, but I always wanted to see basically a snowball fight where you do the lob, and as they're getting ready to duck that lob, you throw a line drive and drill
Boom,
somebody.
Yep.
Which is kind of how I feel like Kraven got him in this one. And I'm like – that was easy. Is anybody taking notes? You know what I mean? Like, Doc Ock.
One of my favorite ways I ever saw a character get taken out, and it has nothing to do with Kraven's last hunt, was Old Man Logan, which was a storyline Mark Millar did in the Wolverine continuity back. What was that done? 2010?
2008.
Same thing. And it was what was it? Mysterio?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was Mysterio tricked Wolverine.
He tricked Wolverine into thinking all the villains were attacking him, but it was actually his own X-Men, and he killed them all.
Whoopsie. He would have smelled them.
It was a huge, like, splash panel of just, like, all the X-Men just in a pile of dead, and he's just like, oh, shit.
Yeah, right. So it's like, sir, the very noble book. Dangerous Sir Lancelot, right?
Oddly enough, the funniest thing I ever remember about that story was the last one standing was Jubilee.
Mm.
After 90 minutes of fighting Bullseye, and it was actually Jubilee as Bullseye.
Yep.
Wow. Jubilee lasted an hour and a half with Logan.
Went round and round. I can see that. She was a badass. The black costume. Now, actually, I want to go back and reread all about the black costume. Sitting here, the black costume was very cool, man.
Black costume was always cool back in the day, and they brought it back in what 2000? Obviously, when Spider-Man 3 was coming out, they did that whole back in black storyline.
Yep.
We should.
It was all right,
man. We should do a Secret Wars chat one night.
Oh hell yeah!
Because that the black costume was only cool because of that, to me. Like,
I agree.
Some arbitrary change never sat well. I like when they got creative about trying to make any changes, and
because it was new and fresh. Today, I feel like a lot of change. They change everything
for the
they
sake.
They just basically put a fresh coat of paint on everything.
Yeah, I can't.
It's almost like everything is recycled over and over and over again.
Has to be. You know, for the new generations of people that are just trying to catch up. Or introduced. Plus, like
how many times have they done a Dark Phoenix story? At least 80 times by now.
Yeah.
I don't know.
In case you want to see it,
there's a Dark Phoenix storyline. It's like, okay, it's been done before.
In case you want to see it drawn by our new artist.
Yeah, this guy's writing it instead of this guy. And
I know when they brought Norman Osborn back, one of the weirdest things they did with him, and I know I told you this, Dan, last time we spoke, was they gave Norman Osborn the Carnage symbiote.
Awesome.
And then he merged it with the Green Goblin serum.
Yeah.
He merged the symbiote with the serum. It was messed up.
It was really messed up.
That just strikes me as one of those moments in one of the Sony Spider-Man films when something happens. And for me, it's always going to be when C. Thomas Howe gets on the radio and he has all the construction cranes flying up. And I literally did this, and this is one of the several times I did it. I watched this unfold in front of my eyes in a movie theater, and I was like, are we okay with this? I'm like, is anybody else calling bullshit on this? I'm like, oh, okay. I did. I looked around to see if anybody was like, oh, they're buying it. You know, they like, so they decided that was going to be in the final draft of the script, and they shot that, and then they watched it, and then they kept it in. I'm like, okay.
I when I saw that scene, because I thought the Amazing movies were, I thought they sucked.
I told somebody recently, it's the best way I can explain it. People are like, oh, are you a fan of those movies? What did you think of them? I'm like, I could sit here and tell you all the things I don't like about them and the few things I do. But the simplest answer I can give you is I have seen each of those movies, whether it's Garfield or Maguire. I have seen each of those movies exactly one time. And I can watch these Tom Holland films over and over and over again. I can watch the Marvel versions. That's the simplest answer I can give.
I get the Holland hype. I do understand why people like him.
Well, and I didn't mean, I just meant to say when Marvel was able to, you know, his inclusion in the MCU. When Sony basically said, can we come play, please? We're sorry.
That's basically what it was. Thank you for saying that, because that's basically what it was. They saw the writing on the wall, and after Amazing 2, disappointed at the box office with their four villains and just crappy storytelling.
And Marvel's crushing it.
Oh, crushed it. Winter Soldier versus Amazing 2 at the box office. Well, summer 14, there was no contest.
And Sony's like, oh, so we are effing this character up. Oh, I see. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, when they came with their hat in their hands and Feige said, sure, but this is how we're going to do it. And we're like, yes, sir. Once he got involved, once Spidey was in with those, then, yeah, I'm 100%. It was a ton of fun. They're always fun. Love them.
I still prefer Toby, though, man. I think that's a nostalgia age thing for me. But
you should, you know, because that was your first – that was your introduction to the character in that venue, in that medium. So
in that medium it was. And then it was, you know, it's funny. I actually remember watching the MTV Spider-Man before I watched a lot of the 94 cartoon.
Okay.
That cell colored CGI one that crap.
Yeah, whatever your first impression is, I still hold a very soft spot. Anybody my age? The Electric Company. If you remember that show, it was like Sesame Street.
Yeah, I've heard of it. I never watched it.
It's the Electric Company.
Yep. And they had your friendly neighborhood Spider-Man come on every now and then. They had an actual look. I'm like, wow, that's really cool. I always think that was really cool. He wasn't perfect because they didn't let him speak, and he didn't have any smart ass comments, and he didn't really do anything like action wise. But it was just cool that he was on the screen. And I would say, I would argue that if they couldn't pull it off, they didn't bother. And I was okay with that. All right, we're not going to have him do any kind of action or shoot webs because we can't do that. But we just want him to appear. And I was like, yes, cool, fun. So,
but he did do that in the 1970s show.
Mm-hmm. No, he didn't. Please let's not go there. Let's just – so about Kraven.
I know. We can't talk the whole story forever because we just kind of summed it up. Kraven beats Spider-Man in two panels, kills him, puts him in a comatose state, and he's buried for 2 weeks, and he's going around breaking people's necks. That's funny. That was actually the funniest part, I thought. Kraven in the costume, you know, giving guys reverse snapmares and just, elbowing dudes in the throat.
And for however implausible it was cool that Mary Jane saw me in the costume and was like, oh, I'm saved. Holy shit.
She's like, that's not Peter.
Yeah.
He's freaking like 6'5", like 250.
You know what? Dude, we should do a what if where we start on this storyline and take it really seriously, and we get to that. What was that? Issue two, maybe, or part two. And she goes, that's not Peter. That's not Peter. Hey, that's buddy. Peter. Like, hey, let's go back to our place. And then she's like, he was wearing your costume.
Didn't she do that?
We could totally do a what if segment and just take the storylines into like a direction that would be cool. Like, what if Hulk couldn't lift the mountain?
Right. And the Beyonder just keeps giving him a redo, like it's Jumanji. Like, come on.
It's like, yeah, it's like Strange with a time stone with Dormammu.
Right. Do it again. Hey, how many scenarios does he hold this whole planet up? One? Shit. It's going to be a long day.
Yeah, and Strange, just like 4,287,006 or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
Just one. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Good stuff, man. The Marvel Universe, good stuff. So I just want to – hey, Tom, before we sign off, if we're, you know, coming to the end, I just want to make sure we always sign off if I'm on the show with, hey, Kevin Feige. I'm ready.
Give this man a call. This man has made the greatest Spider-Man video, and he's got the most creative knowledge in Spider-Man.
Due. Yeah, he's due. Yeah. Cameron.
Give this man his due.
Yeah.
Me and Cameron just kind of, yeah, but – I met Feige a couple times. He's a good dude, man. He's a good guy. I like him. When he first met me, it was really funny because he seemed to he knew my name. And he was like excited to meet me. Seemingly,
man, your name carries a lot of clout with a lot of Spider-Man fans.
Right, and yep. So I was excited to meet this guy. I wasn't even sure how to pronounce his name. It was early on.
I totally butchered it.
I think we all did.
Oh yeah, but. But as we're walking, my point being, I would see him at Comic-Cons before he was well-known, before people knew who he was and what he looked like.
Yeah.
And I'd go up and say hi to him. And it just seemed like he had less and less excitement and respect for me the more his grew. Oh, was he Kraven to my Spider-Man? That mother – no. You know, the last time I met him, I walked up to him and said, hey, Kevin, how you been? He's like, oh, Dan, hi. And then he introduced me to a friend of his. And he goes, Dan, oh, I don't know if these are exact words, but it's what it felt like. He said, oh, Dan made this little video a long time ago about Spider-Man. And I was like, is that where we are? I was like, okay, all right, that's cool. Like, yeah. And I'm like, and what did you do as a resume? I'm sorry. Oh, just graduated film school? Okay.
While you swung off a rooftop in Baltimore.
Yeah. Whatever.
Sounds like his ego kind of took control of his.
I can't say. I still think he's a good dude. I always liked talking with him. Always liked it. Yeah, I met him three times. Always loved talking with Kevin. Yeah. Nice, good.
Billions of dollars can change a man.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Hey, money talks. Look at
Charlie Sheen.
Money talks.
I enjoyed our little in-depth discussion. It wasn't as in-depth. I knew we weren't going to go like in.
I was ready, man.
You were ready to go in on page 3, panel 4?
Yeah. Did you look? I'll tell you this. I did notice somewhere, and I decided not to go that deep, but I noticed the ink like outside of the line, like on somebody. I was like, wow, I never really looked at that. Yeah. Oh, now he's looking. Tom's looking, man. I'll find it. I'll shoot. I tell you what. I'll find it and I'll shoot you a screenshot of or a picture of it because it's in part 1 or 2.
Yeah, shoot me that video. Shoot me that panel.
Yeah, we'll call it out, man.
Done. We could shoot that in my dad's garage.
I don't even want to know. I don't even want to ask about your father's garage.
Come in. Let's do it.
Tell you when we're off live. Yeah, this was the weird part though. The whole like Kraven doing the getaway and the it's just nuts.
Well, the way they covered it, yeah. You know, with his whole the psycho, the edibles he was doing, the potions and gassing himself with hallucinogens or whatever.
Gassed himself and was doing hallucinogens.
He drank a lot of kombucha, right? And then just started gassing himself.
When you were rereading it, Dan, did you have a favorite part? Like a favorite issue where you were just like, man, that grabbed me more than the other ones. Like, whether it was the imagery or anything like that.
Yeah, but not in a good way. I'll say that the first panel grabbed me because yep. I love that pose. Yes, that was like, ooh, I remember this was fun. I will say also that it was fun to revisit how Kraven just came into town and just grabbed Spidey, just grabbed him. I was like, damn, they made quick work.
I think the fourth issue had some of the best, obviously the cover.
For sure.
And then Peter coming out of the grave.
Yeah. But there were several things that grabbed me in a way that was like, wow, I actually thought this was good writing, like the dialogue, because now I've got an ear for, you know, on-screen dialogue, real actor dialogue. And I'm like, that is real comic booky dialogue. But the one thing that really
comic booky
is this is what got me, dude. You ready? No, it's not in there.
Show me. Somewhere. Show us.
Well, this isn't the color part. This is a part that really got me. And so in the very beginning, when Spidey goes to that guy's funeral.
Yep.
And they're all and he's making a big deal out of death and everything. I'm like, what's with the money? Like, why is he throwing money at this guy's I just didn't get the cash. Like, Spidey's whipping out all this wad of cash and throwing it in this guy's
collection. Was it Mary Jane's? He probably took it from Mary Jane when she was doing those commercials in the soap opera.
Hey, Sticky Fingers, what are you doing with my guy? It wasn't me. All the ones from your gig last night.
Nice.
Anyway, I have a building pressure in my lower abdomen that I'm going to
As
have.
Do I.
Yeah, okay.
So, Don, you got anything in closing before we split up?
Nah, good. Thanks for coming on the show. Appreciate it.
It's a ton of fun. Yeah, I'm excited to do it whenever there's a need or fun. This is fun. I don't know how fun it is for your viewers, but I enjoy being here. So thanks for having me.
A few likes, many views. Hey, we do our thing.
One for all of us.
Yeah. Right.
It's what we love.
We're not out changing the world. We just want to have a little bit of fun.
Just want to talk about comics, man. It's great.
Comics, movies, we're in for anything, man.
Yeah.
All right, I'm picking the next one, and it might very well be Secret Wars.
It's all you. We'll leave it up to you.
All right,
in closing, I want to thank everyone who tuned in tonight and watched. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, share everything. You know, we love it. Ooh, we're getting a couple of comments. David and Kelly Adams say, thanks, fellas. And it is fun. It is fun from Chelsea Langelier and Diane Langelier, two of our biggest fans.
All right. Thanks.
In closing, though, before I sign off, I just want to say that this broadcast was brought to you by Tasty at Tuesday. Check out all of her bad for your health dishes on her Facebook page. I share a lot of her posts on the Facebook page. Dan, I'll send some of them to you if you want to check them out.
I do.
Also brought to you by R&B Catering and my main man, Peter Schreff, at Out of This World Jewelry. For Dan Poole, Dunzilla, thank you very much. And stay tuned next week. We have a special guest. We'll be the writer of Daredevil from the 90s, Dan Chichester.
I will be tuning in. I'll be watching.
Excellent.
Nice.
Have a good
Dunzilla,
week.
Dan Poole, I'm Tom. Good night, everybody.